In molecular biology, most experiments include a step where we want to see the molecules that we're working with. For example, suppose we're testing whether an enzyme can cut DNA at a specific sequence location. We might start by mixing the enzyme with some DNA of known sequence. But how do we know if anything happened? Did the enzyme cut at the expected location? Did the reaction go to completion? Typically, we would use gel electrophoresis to find out. Gel electrophoresis is one of the best and most widely used techniques for characterizing biomolecules. A gel is a porous molecular sieve, and it can be used to separate mixtures of molecules and spread them out over a large area for visualization. For this segment, we're going to focus on separation of DNA with agarose gels. But bear in mind that other molecules like RNA and proteins can be separated with other types of gels. Let's see what happens when we perform electrophoresis on this sample. We can use a pipette to transfer a small amount of the sample into a well in the gel. Once the sample is loaded, we can connect the gel apparatus to a power source and apply a current. The resulting electric field exerts a force on the negatively charged molecules, and they migrate towards the positive terminal. Meanwhile, the gel acts as a sieve. Smaller molecules tend to move more quickly through the gel, while larger molecules move slowly. After an hour or two, the individual species will separate according to how fast they move, and when enough of the molecules migrate at the same speed, they can be visualized as bands. Typically, each band is comprised of billions of individual molecules. Once the gel has run for a sufficient amount of time, the next step is typically to scan the gel slab and acquire a digital image. Now that we have an idea of what the gel does, let's revisit our original questions and see how we can design our experiment to get more meaningful data. First, we almost always include a reference sample that will produce bands of known sizes. This is called a ladder. If we scan our gel and see the ladder, we know that the gel is working and we can tell exactly how fast certain band sizes are running. On the other hand, if the ladder bands are distorted or missing, we already have a hint that something might be wrong with our gel preparation, or perhaps with the ladder itself. Thinking about the question of how our enzyme cuts the DNA, we may want to include another sample in our experiment that shows us what happens if the enzyme doesn't cut the DNA at all. One approach would be to prepare a sample that is nearly identical to the first sample, except we would replace the enzyme with an equal volume of water. This control sample should give us a precise reference band for any uncut DNA in our experiment and serve as a sanity check that we in fact started with the correct DNA as input. Finally, the full reaction sample would go in our third lane. Now when we run the gel, we get a lot of information. We see that the ladder bands are running at the expected sizes. We see that the uncut DNA is also the expected size. And we see that the two smaller bands correspond to two pieces of DNA that resulted from a single cut at the expected site. If there's a trace amount of uncut DNA, we could quantify the relative amount to get an idea of the efficiency of our reaction. All of this planning also made us better prepared to notice unexpected results, which can be the harbingers of new discoveries. More commonly, we'll simply move forward with our research using the information we gained from the gel. If we need to isolate specific molecules for further analysis, we can do that as well. Even though we just scratched the surface in this segment, hopefully you now appreciate why gels are such a powerful and integral part of molecular biology research.